Welcome to Innovations in Education. I'm your host, Santa Barbara County Superintendent of Schools, Bill Cerrone. Here's a look at what's coming up. Oh! We'll join some fifth graders exploring chemistry at a UCSB lab. And we'll close the show with our calendar of educational events. The fifth grade chemistry outreach program at UCSB offers hands-on experiences for local students. It's a wonderful way to stimulate interest in the sciences.
This is the fifth grade chemistry outreach program, and it started back in 1999. I was volunteering in my kids' classes because teachers would say, oh, you're a scientist, you have to come do science, you know? So then I decided, well, why not bring the kids out to the university? So first I brought an honors class in, but then I go, you know what? I want everyone to come here.
So welcome to UCSB. My name is Emma and I'm a student here at UCSB. I'm a biology student and I study chemistry as well. So you guys are in an actual chemistry lab here at UCSB. So today you guys are gonna have the opportunity to be chemists and to do your own experiments, which is really exciting. So before we get started, we're gonna have to talk about a couple things that chemists do and that are really important to chemistry. So does anybody know what this is?
Oh yeah, I do.
Yeah?
It's a table of like paradoxes and stuff.
Yeah, the periodic table, right? That's awesome. No, great. Does anybody know what these little boxes on the periodic table are? Yeah.
So we developed this fifth grade program to have activities that are in line with the standards that they are learning in fifth grade. And fifth grade has great physical science that they cover, and we can tie into what they're learning in the classroom. We have an introduction so that a faculty kind of gets them engaged into asking and answering questions and providing information and having them get excited about what's ahead.
So this is 3% hydrogen peroxide. This is a hydrogen peroxide I can buy here at UCSB. And this is 30% hydrogen peroxide. 50 milliliters of our 30% H2O2. Are we getting bubbles?
No.
No, not very exciting, right? So let's think about this for a second. Do you guys know what this is?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, what? Soap. So I'm gonna pour some soap into my eye. All right, so are we getting bubbles? So the thing in our blood that causes this reaction is called catalase, but in the lab, we can use something called potassium iodide to kind of mimic this. What does that look like?
Powder.
It kind of looks like powder. What color is it?
White.
Is it a solid, a liquid, or a gas?
Solid.
Solid. It's a solid, right? What do we have in our beaker right now?
Liquid.
Or in our graduated cylinder, pardon me. Yeah, we have a liquid, right? All right, do you guys want to see what happens when
yeah,
we combine them?
It's going to go bubble.
All right, let's see.
Oh, I knew it!
Can I have you do me a favor? Can you just put your hands, don't touch it, but just kind of put it there. All right, awesome. What do you feel?
How did it do that?
All right, go ahead and take a step back from me. All right, guys, so I have a question for you. Did we have a chemical reaction?
Yeah.
Yeah, how do we know? What's one way you know we had a chemical reaction? What's something that's different than what we started with? So we had a color change. What else? How else do we know we had a chemical reaction? We started out with a solid and a liquid. So with your fingers, can you guys show me how much solid and liquid we started out with? Yeah, like about that much. Now with your arms, can you show me how much gas we got out? Yeah, we got a lot of gas. So which one takes up more space? Solids and liquids or gases?
It's
gases. Awesome. By little or by a lot?
By
a lot, right? So we call this a change of phase or change of state, and that's also evidence of a chemical reaction.
It's a great field trip. I mean, what I like about it is that it aligns with our curriculum, and it really exposes the students to higher education, which is something that we really want to promote at school. So if we can attend or go to different activities where we go to UCSB or City College, it's just making it more realistic for the students to actually believe that they can make it here.
Okay, so does anybody know any animal that produces light?
A firefly! The firefly!
How about this one? Has anyone seen the fish that looks like this?
Yeah, it has a
What's the name of that fish?
The anglerfish.
The anglerfish, okay. Has anybody heard of plankton before?
Yeah.
plankton. So what are plankton? Are they very big or really small?
Really,
really small, right? So these plankton, when they multiply and then when they get large amounts of them, they're called red tide. And they're a species that if you disturb them, they produce light. The reason it's called red tide is because if you go during the day, the ocean will look a reddy brown color. But if you go at night, you're going to see something like this in dark areas. Here is our sand, here's our ocean, and here's where the waves are crashing. If you walk along, your footprints will glow. Being a chemist, I'm interested in what is the molecules inside these atoms that are allowing it to produce light. And so we could figure that out, and we can find out that it is something called luminol, and let's look at our luminol. What does our luminol look like?
Blue.
It's a nice, pretty blue color. Okay? It turns out in every single one of our cells, we have some hydrogen peroxide. So let's look at our hydrogen peroxide again. What color is our hydrogen peroxide?
Clear.
Clear? Okay. So let's go ahead and see what happens when we mix these two things together. Are we ready?
It's gonna glow.
Oh! Is a chemical reaction happening? How do we know?
In fifth grade, we learn about mixtures and solutions. So they're learning mostly about the physical changes in liquids and solids and how they interact. So seeing that happen in a lab as opposed to in the classroom kind of helps make those ideas more concrete for them.
The kids get so excited when they come out here, and we want them to get excited about learning. It doesn't really matter what they do, but if once they get excited about something, they usually start working harder and doing better and loving school. So that's our goal, is to engage them in science and just have them have an experience that the university is for them too.
So do you guys want to do your own experiments?
Yes!
We have them divided into groups because there's five different activities, and we want them all to be in their groups and rotating through the activities so that everyone gets an opportunity to do all the activities.
So this substance is something we call liquid nitrogen.
Yeah.
And liquid nitrogen is really, really cool. And I mean, like, literally, it's really cool because it is negative 200 degrees Celsius. Is that cold? Yeah, that's really cold. To put that in perspective, do you guys know what temperature water freezes at? Water freezes at 0 degrees Celsius. If this is negative 200 degrees Celsius, is this stuff cold? Yeah, it's really cold. Do we want to touch it?
No.
No. Do we want to drink it?
No.
No, but we are going to do some really cool experiments with it, okay?
There's liquid nitrogen where they learn all about phase changes, property changes as temperatures increase and decrease, and they love this because they can't believe it. A racquetball that is nice and bouncy actually, when it freezes, shatters, which is just amazing.
Solid rubber or hollow rubber?
Hollow.
Yeah, hollow, right? So when I bounce the ball, what's on the inside?
Nothing.
Nothing. Well, not nothing. Air, right? Air's on the inside. So when I bounce it, the air inside the ball, it gets compressed, but it doesn't like being compressed. So when it decompresses, that's what causes the ball to bounce. All right, so I'm gonna see what happens when I put this ball in the liquid nitrogen. Are you guys ready?
Yeah.
All right, so we're gonna make some observations. What do you guys notice? What's happening? It's bubbling, awesome. What's another word for bubbling? If you guys ever go in the kitchen and you make pasta, what do you do
boil.
To the water? Yeah, you boil it, right? But wait, when you boil water, are you making it really hot or really cold?
Hot.
You're making it really hot. But didn't I say liquid nitrogen is really cold? Is the ball the same temperature as the liquid nitrogen?
No.
No, definitely not, right? How cold is liquid nitrogen? Do you guys remember?
Negative
200 degrees Celsius. So the ball is so hot compared to liquid nitrogen that it's actually boiling the liquid nitrogen around it. Pretty crazy, huh? Awesome, are you guys ready?
Yes.
Okay. All right, guys, so did that ball bounce?
No.
No, right? All right, so we're gonna take a look at this piece. So you guys can go ahead and feel it. It's really cold. Don't leave your hand on it too long. It's really cold and it's really hard, right? It's like frozen.
So they learn a lot about just phase changes and properties of materials.
Today, we went to the chemistry lab and we learned about gases, solids, and liquids.
My favorite was the liquid nitrogen because they broke a ball.
I like science because it's actually really fun and you can learn a lot of things you never knew about. Today here at UCSB, we experimented with chemicals and many acids, and we learned about gases, and it was a lot of fun.
Other station which they totally love is lighting methane bubbles. And a combustion reaction is important for them to understand and what it is.
So your job right now as scientists is to blow bubbles, and your job is to make observations. So observations are all the stuff you can see about what we're doing. What shape are they?
Circles, spheres.
A 3D circle is a sphere, very good. And now let's look about how they move. Are they floating straight up?
No.
Or do they sink? They sink. So do heavy things sink or do light things sink?
Heavy.
Heavy things. So do you guys know what bubbles are made out of?
Oxygen.
Let's think about that. What do we breathe in?
Oxygen.
What do we breathe in?
Oxygen.
What do we breathe out?
Carbon dioxide.
Very good. And we're breathing out into the bubble. So all these bubbles are filled with carbon dioxide. And you said it, carbon dioxide is now a heavy gas. So now that we know carbon dioxide is a heavy gas, do you guys know of any gases that are light and float very easily? Oxygen does float. That's how it stays in the air and we can breathe it in. Hydrogen floats really well too. And methane gas right here is CH4. So it's one carbon and four hydrogens. So if hydrogen floats really well, do you think methane that has a lot of hydrogens will float well too? Should we find out?
Yes.
So it's much different than carbon dioxide. It's not sinking to the floor. So all these gases have different properties. So if you guys come in close, I'll let you pop it this time. Go ahead, pop the bubble, just poke it. And everyone take a small sniff.
It smells like gas.
It smells really stinky. Have you smelled this before?
Yes.
Where? It's not the same gas as the gas station. It's actually somewhere in your house. Not the trash. The oven or the stove. So if you have a gas oven or stove, this is the gas that it uses. And you use the stove and oven to heat stuff, right? It makes a fire. So if you think methane makes fire, it's very safe to have all the time?
No.
So methane actually has no smell normally, but we add smell to it so we know where it is. So if you walk into a room and it smells really, really stinky like that, you don't want to stay there because methane gas is not good for you. And you can point it up a little bit higher. Reach. There you go.
Oh,
perfect.
Nice job.
And I love the students' questions. Like one student asked, they're observing this bubble of methane lighting up and they go, wow, what is fire? And the undergraduate goes, what is fire? Let's do this again. So they observe some more bubbles and lighting these bubbles and it floats up. It just looks amazing, right? And they go, oh, it's light and heat. And we go, yeah, that's what's fire, light and heat, you know? So it's great for them to be able to answer their own questions, right? And by making observations, that's what we want them to do. Then in that station too, we move over to the bin with the dry ice inside, which is so much fun. They blow bubbles on top of this layer of, so we have frozen carbon dioxide, then a layer of carbon dioxide gas. When you blow bubbles, the bubbles kind of float on top of this layer because they're slightly lighter than the carbon dioxide gas.
So they're not sinking right away, but they're also not floating outside of the box. So we can think of it like a little sandwich. So if we have a lot of nitrogen up here, and carbon dioxide down here, our bubble stays in the middle.
My favorite experiment was when the methane bubbles, they went up and the flame catched it.
Then there is the dry ice activity. They observe solid CO2 and compare that to solid ice water.
Is this dry ice?
No.
What is this?
Ice.
Just regular ice, right? How can you tell? Let's make some observations. It's clear. What else? What other observations? I'm touching it. Very good.
And
it melts.
It doesn't have like gas coming.
You're right. There's no gas that's coming off of it. So it's you said it melts, right? It's going from a solid to a
liquid.
Very good. All right, that process is called melting. Now let's look at dry ice. What can you tell me?
It's not transparent.
Doesn't melt, it's not transparent. I'm not touching it. The smoke coming off of it, very good. But there's no liquid, right? It's going straight from the solid to a?
Liquid.
Gas. To a gas, very good. It's going straight from a solid to a gas. You guys know what that process is called? It's okay if you don't. It's a big word. It's up there on the board. Can you all say it?
Sublimation.
That's right. It says sublimation. One more time. Can you all say it?
Sublimation.
So water is just H2O, right? And ice is also H2O. So when something changes states of matter, it doesn't change chemically. It's still the same substance. So if the ice is made of CO2, what gas do you think this is? CO2. Very good. It's still just carbon dioxide. So if this gas is CO2, do you guys think it's heavy or light? Raise your hand for light. Raise your hand for heavy. So let's take your hands and lightly touch the top and just see what it feels like.
Wait. It's warm.
Feels kind of warm, right?
Oh my God, I can't see.
Can you see what's going on down there?
No.
Look at the side of the tank.
It's bubbling.
Yeah, it's bubbling, right? It seems like it's boiling almost.
Well, we started the year with mixtures and solutions, which is similar to what they did here with the chemical reactions and how to separate things. And it was nice for them to see it in a bigger scale than what we've been doing in class. It's been little things here and there in class, but to actually be at the university and see things explode or shatter because of the dry ice, I think really kind of got them a little more motivated to keep learning that science.
So our build up to this was more about kind of just showing them, having them observe and see changes, see how things change and are impacted by adding different things like liquids or solids.
Welcome to Reaction in a Bag. We are going to do a reaction in a bag. But first we're going to make some observations because we are scientists. So I want you guys to go ahead and pick up these beakers right here, move the spoon around and tell me what you feel. What do you notice? Go ahead.
Then they do a chemical reaction in a bag, which is great because in fifth grade they learn all about observing chemical reactions. Okay, banana turns brown. Okay, what's actually happening? We grow. What's actually happening? So in these chemical reactions, they observe what actually has happened. So they see two solids, when they mix them with some indicator and some liquid, water, and they see a gas being formed, they see a color change, they feel heat.
This is calcium chloride. So we're gonna do a reaction now with calcium chloride and sodium bicarbonate. So what you do is you take your spoon and use the back of the knife to level out a scoop. We are scientists, be nice and precise about this. So go ahead and put one level scoop into your bag. So this time, we're gonna add calcium chloride. It's real easy to add this. You just get a scoop, you shake it level, and then you're gonna add two level scoops into your bag, all right? Two level scoops, just like that, perfect. One partner is gonna get down eye level. The other partner is gonna pour in this red liquid. And we're going to fill it up to this red line. Go ahead and tell your partner to stop when they get to this black line. Okay. Go ahead and do it. It is water, but it's water with something in it. And what's in it is a chemical called phenyl red. Now, phenyl red is an indicator. It indicates something. So phenyl red tells us if we have an acid present in our solution. Phenyl red will turn yellow in the presence of an acid. So right now, it's just in water. Is there any acid in here? No, but if it was yellow, what would that tell us? Acid, bingo, keep that in mind. So now coming back to our bags, you're gonna go ahead and shake all the solids into one corner. Don't close it. Very good, all into one corner. All into one corner, shake it all. Grab all the solid and twist it up so it's kind of stuck in this little pouch and hold that nice and tight. So we have like a pouch type of thing going on here. And pour the phenyl red into here. Don't let go of the solid, hold that nice and tight, but go ahead and pour the phenyl red in. And then go ahead and seal your bag up. Once we're all sealed now, very good sealing, guys. Now on the count of three, we're gonna grab the corners of our bag and shake. Ready, one, two, three, shake. Let go of the solid and shake. What do you guys see? It's hot? It's hot, what else do we see? So what did we see? We've seen, we got heat, we got bubbles, right? We have a gas forming. If you guys see, it's kind of expanding a little bit. And we also have a color change. Do you guys remember what this yellow color means?
Acid.
Acid, bingo. So this is telling us that water and carbon dioxide react together to form an acid. So can you guys think of a place where this reaction might happen on Earth? Let's think, where's a large body of water?
Ocean.
And where might I find carbon dioxide?
From us,
right in the air all around us, right? We breathe it out, we make it all the time. Exactly, right? So do you think in the ocean with all the waves crashing around, do you think they mix with the air?
Yeah.
Yeah, so do you think this exact same reaction is happening?
Yeah.
Yeah, right? Chemistry happens exactly the same way every single time. This reaction is happening in our oceans.
And it actually is the global carbon cycle. So because we produce CO2, the CO2 goes in the air, the ocean absorbs the CO2 and settles out into carbon, calcium carbonate. So that's kind of what they're doing. And there's a follow-up activity to that that we give the teachers that they can do in their classrooms, which is really neat.
All right, guys. So today we are being super awesome scientists, and part of being awesome scientists is making observations. I'm going to show you guys a chemical reaction. What do you guys notice is different? They're stacked, that's exactly right. So we have an oxygen with two hydrogens. Does anyone know what H2O is called?
Water,
right? So this is a chemical reaction for water. But what's really important is what's not different is we started with four hydrogens, right? And we ended with four. We started with two oxygen and we ended with two. So in science, we're not allowed to create or destroy any matter. And that's really important, all right? I like to think of it like Legos, right? Do you guys play with Legos? I love to play with Legos. So if you start with a Lego and you want to build something, you can build anything you want, but you can't just get rid of a Lego or just magically create a Lego. But what we can do in science is if we took a purple Lego and did a really good job at painting it pink, do you think we could trick our friends into thinking it's a pink Lego? Yeah? I think we can, and we're gonna do exactly that today with pennies.
Each of the students are asked to bring two very bright, shiny pennies, and by coating them with some zinc, okay, so we have copper, and now we have a layer of zinc on top. And then students take these pennies and heat them in a Bunsen burner. And the atoms, when they heat up, they actually move slightly. And so copper and zinc atoms mix, and you get this beautiful, what looks like gold, even though it's brass, but it looks like really a nice thing. And they have to know about alloys, so it's nice for them to know that we can actually coat materials with other metals to protect them, like musical instruments, for example.
What did you guys do to your pennies? You burnt them, right? You held them over the fire. And what does fire give? Heat, right? And heat in science is just a big fancy word for energy. So what they started to do is they started to mix around on that layer when we gave them a bunch of heat, and they make that really pretty gold color, right? So we didn't make gold, right? We made something that looks like gold. We made a mixture of two metals. You made brass today.
I think the benefit is that they see what science really can look like. They get to experience it for themselves. We want them to grow up enthusiastic about science, and even if they don't become scientists, we want them interested and literate in science. So I think seeing the lab here and working with the students at least helped to fuel a flame that hopefully will grow as they get older.
The kids remember this trip. They remember the activities that they do, but what I like is that they remember coming to the school. It really makes it come to life for them, the university lifestyle, seeing the students walk around, and seeing scientists with their lab coats and everything really kind of makes it more real to them than just doing it inside our classroom.
They can choose to do different activities on campus. We sometimes tie in with engineering to do another activity, or they walk around school, or they go to marine science. So they can choose what they want to do.
When we took the tour, we got to see the library, the place where like everyone hangs out.
Yeah, I want to go to this college because it looks fun and it's really big. Oh, I do want to go to college to get a good education.
We hope you have enjoyed this program. We'll close now with our calendar of educational events. Thank you for joining us, and we invite you to tune in next time for more Innovations in Education.